Yo, what's going on, Dragon Ballers? Welcome back to another Top Cut Breakdown. In today's video, we're going over the Core TCG Online webcam tournament that took place over the weekend. This is probably the biggest tournament we've had since the pandemic started, probably, because this was about 120 players, and no event in my recent memory in all of Set 10 has even hit close to this number. So pretty cool to go over this top 16 here. Lots of info to talk about. So guys, if you are new here, make sure to subscribe, hit that bell so you don't miss a video. If you want to help the channel out, there are tons of ways down in the description to do so. Make sure to check out the Gemmy app and the Patreon for your one-on-one coaching with yours truly, as well as your Crosswell competitive content. Make sure to check out Dex Protection down below for your sleeves, deck boxes, binders, all that stuff you'll need for card storage. And finally, guys, if you want to buy any of the cards you see in today's video, make sure to use my link in the description to TCG Player. All that stuff really helps out a great deal, guys. I do appreciate each and every one of you that does that stuff for the channel. That being said, let's get started with the top 16 breakdown. So firstly, we had 3 Vegex, 2 Fuse Zamasu, 2 Blue Vegito, 1 Reboot Gohan, 1 Skillless, 1 Invoker, 1 Lord Slug, believe it or not, 1 Dredge Goku, 1 Soul Striker Reboot, 1 Bulma, 1 Broly, and 1 Black Boo. Now I will say we've seen a lot of leaders in this top cut already that we don't normally see. That is granted going to be due to the fact that this is a top 16, not a top 8. Most of the tournaments we've done before have been top 8s. So I think when you see a top 8 versus top 16, you'll see a little bit more specificity in the top 8. Like, you know, some of the stronger decks will, you know, break into the top 8 as opposed to top 16. But nonetheless, big tournament, so we will go over the top 16. It is very, very cool to see. So starting off with Vegex, of course, this is a pre-Bibbidi Errata tournament. We just got that announcement on Friday. That doesn't take place until set 11 is released. So it's kind of no shock here that Vegex is, you know, the deck with the most representation in the top cut. I think we still see just a ton of players playing it. That could definitely be a combination of players, you know, just wanting to play it before it does get its eventual nerf, but it still just seems to be incredibly strong. I mean, the amount of things Vegex does for zero energy, you know, playing your Unison, playing your Time Agents, playing your Supreme Kais, which is a free 10k combo, you know, that can actually make up for the lack of power in Bibbidi. But that's talking about the future. We're more so talking about this format, and Vegex just seems like it is the best deck in set 10 format. You know, we did have a pretty fair amount of time with set 10. I guess you can say Anniversary Box 2020 included. And a lot of people like to say, you know, product comes out so fast that we don't get enough time with a format. But what's funny is, you know, for the lack of IRL tournaments we've had in set 10, it seems like we've had a lot of time with set 10 format. Again, granted, Anniversary Box included, but it's really all just set 10 format, and we've had a lot of time with it. It seems like Vegex has established itself as the best deck in the format, quite possibly. But what's going to be really cool about the rest of the top 16 is there are quite a few decks here that are going to pretty much just aim to counter Vegex, and we'll talk about those kind of as we get into them. And next up, nothing we haven't seen before, 2 Fuse Zamasu in the top cut. If it wasn't for Vegex, it could honestly be said that blue might be the strongest in this format. Now, you do have your different variations of blue, which we will talk about in this top 16. However, Zamasu kind of just has an unrivaled amount of advantage that it gains, and that's going to be anything from the dual attack, potential double strike with Encouraging Presence Menaka. Couple that with your leader drawing twice on each swing, or drawing once on each swing rather, that's going to be incredibly strong. And besides that, the deck has access to a ton of strong boss monsters. Look at the Goku Black 9 drop. You can either drop it on turn 2 or turn 3 for a huge triple strike that your opponent quite possibly won't be able to defend, or you drop it later in the game when your opponent has 5 energy, you snipe their 2 open energy, and then right then and there, that's a triple strike they're probably not going to be able to negate unless they have like a free Unison negate or like a Sparking negate, right? So that's pretty strong there. Couple that with the fact that you're playing essentially a ramp deck with the Zeno and Unison, Super 17 turning the tide. I don't know why I keep calling it Super 17 when it's just Android 17, but Android 17 turning the tide is an incredibly strong blue boss monster. You know, Gogeta 7 got kicked out of the game, it's banned, but turning the tide is probably the next best replacement. Yeah, you have to pay 7 as opposed to possibly paying 5 for Gogeta 7, but turning the tide has proved to be a very, very strong force this format. And you look at other top end boss monsters, Fu Shrouded Mystery, SS4 Gogeta Peerless Fusion, Black Smoke Dragon, these blue, you know, somewhat ramp decks. They're not like true ramp decks because if you kill the Zeno Unison, they don't keep the ramp. But regardless, these quote unquote ramp decks, they have access to some of the strongest game enders in the game. So it's no surprise that with the amount of value Zamasu generates, as well as the boss monsters at its disposal, that it's doing so well in set 10. Next up, we're talking about Blue Vegito. I've always talked about this, guys. When you look at Mono Blue, you have your different leaders that add different things to the engine. So when you look at Zamasu, like I talked about before, you have this unrivaled value where it draws you a ton of cards. When you look at Vegito, you have the ability to awaken early, turn any blue card into a cycle, basically. You know, block, it dies, untap, draw one. And then besides that, you're awakening early, so 10k leaders and 10k battle cards don't do damage to you. And that's actually very, very relevant in a lot of matchups, especially ones that are trying to go aggressive with some smaller battle cards and their leader doesn't get flipped too quickly, right? So Vegito, once again, not surprised to see it here. It does have the same thing as Zamasu in terms of access to really, really strong boss monsters. So that being the case, I mean, it is no surprise that Vegito is here in the top cut. But as we go around the top 16, it gets a lot more interesting. So one reboot Gohan, this deck ended up getting first place in the tournament. And we saw a lot of reboot Gohan representation in last week's online top cut event. The deck was just everywhere. Going back to Aspira's Invoker, you know, meta breakdown slash tournament report where he played Invoker and placed very highly, there was a lot of reboot Gohan in that tournament. So it's no surprise this deck is seeing a lot of play. In these online tournaments, you know, there's still a budget factor as well, and Reboot Gohan is probably one of the strongest budget decks you can play. You don't need a super fancy SCR. You don't need, like, Raiders Warcries. You don't need a Exploited Weakness Vegeta. The deck is just fast, aggressive. You play it, you know, kind of the way you want to. You can play a blue-green, mono-green, yellow-green has seen some success. So there's so many customizable ways to play Reboot Gohan, and it's such a strong budget pick. And it got first place in this tournament, especially a best of one tournament. Keep in mind, this was a best of one format. So again, aggro is going to do quite well in these formats, especially an aggro deck like Reboot Gohan, because we all know that yellow has one of the best answers to Reboot Gohan in Release from Evil, but most yellow decks are not main decking that card. There's actually a lack of yellow in this top cut, which is actually really interesting. No Sin Shenron, no Gotenks. Now, if I were to take Gotenks or Sin Shenron into this tournament, I would probably main 1 to 2 copies of Release from Evil, just because I know players are probably gonna play Reboot Gohan at this tournament, but other players might not be of the same mentality. They might not be thinking the same, or they may have just steered away from yellow altogether because of the best of one format. But besides that, Reboot Gohan is gonna do quite well in a best of one format, especially where their opponents are not main decking the anti-aggro options that they may need to combat it. So congratulations to the Reboot Gohan player for getting first place. Very, very cool to see. Next up, we're talking about Skillless. Man, tried and true Skillless. It's just a deck that will never die, and I'm pretty happy to see that. I mean, I love this deck if you guys have followed the channel for any amount of time. What's really cool about Skillless in this format with the Anniversary Box 2020 support is that it really is, in a lot of ways, an anti-blue deck. And what I mean by that is you're spamming 10k attackers to the board. This deck has the easiest time dealing with Zeno Unison amongst any of the decks in the format. I mean, for one energy with the Goku Jr., Vegeta Jr. Unison, you swing with that, that's one 10k swing at a Zeno. Minus one, you get two more 10k attackers, that's two more markers off Zeno. And then your leader swing, that's the fourth marker off Zeno. And if that didn't kill it, either the next turn or the same turn, you can go into your Android 8 slash Son Goku, attack with that for 15k, get two more Skillless out of the deck. It's just absolutely insane how crazy this deck can spam. And even later in the game, you can turn those 10k attackers into 15ks, 20ks, very, very easily with some of the other support cards in the deck. I mean, this deck is just one of the ones that draws the most cards in the entire format. So when you couple that, the fact that this deck gains so much advantage, the fact that this deck deals with blue very, very well, which is one of the best decks in the format, which we just talked about, I mean, it's no wonder that Skillless is positioned to do quite well. I'm actually really interested to see how Skillless meshes with Skillless Gohan come set 11, because in a way, they're very similar. They both rely around Skillless battle cards. They both gain advantages off of using Skillless battle cards, but in some ways they do it pretty similarly. In some ways they do it kind of differently, but once again, interested to see how that works out in set 11. We'll see if either, you know, Bonds of Friendship Goku's here to stay, if Skillless Gohan's here to, you know, take over. We'll see if they kind of mesh together. That'll be interesting. Next up, one Invoker in the top 16. Last week, we saw a resurgence of Invoker, and it doesn't seem like it's slowing down. This deck was nowhere to be found, you know, since week one of set 10 format, back, I think, in like the Virginia Beach tournament when I covered those several weeks ago. Invoker made a crazy splash in the meta last tournament, and it looks like it's just here to stay. And what's really interesting about Invoker is, you know, there's been no nerf to it. There's been nothing that really restricts the deck. The deck is at full power. And I think when you look at Invoker, it really is just a matter of, are you well experienced with the deck? Because it is relatively difficult to pilot. And that's not to say that, you know, playing Victory Strike is hard or burning your opponent to death is difficult. What it means to say is that this deck can fold under immense pressure. And if you don't know how to properly use your topos, if you don't know how to properly manage your combo power, because the deck doesn't have an abundance of combo power at its disposal, I mean, you can be in for a rough time. So I think this is a deck that does reward, you know, a certain amount of dedication to it. But I think one thing we saw last week that's definitely going to, you know, improve upon this deck was the introduction of Tyrannical Assault Cooler. That was a card that we haven't seen in Invoker really since its inception, and it's been a card that players have used to, you know, stall out aggro. Basically, playing it down gives you almost like a 20k combo because you'll super combo, untap your energy, arrive it, and then minus 10 to threats. That's going to be very, very high value for playing defense. And again, it's not a card that we thought we'd see in Invoker because it doesn't go with the theme. It doesn't help you burn your opponent. Or I guess in a way it kind of does, because that 20k double strike early on can be tough to defend. So getting your opponent to maybe like 5 life, then burning them from 5 to 0 can be quite good. And then of course, Victory Strike's an insane card. Once again, best of one format. Very, very likely players were not maining their drop negates. And when that's the case, I mean, it's no surprise that Invoker will take advantage of that and just Victory Strike people for game all day, rip their negates out of their hand, and call it a day. So Invoker definitely expected to see it. But Slug did not expect to see this at all. I mean, green is strong. I've been saying it. It's been missing top cuts here and there. I mean, well, actually, for a lot of set 10 formats, been missing top cuts. But Slug was not the leader I expected to see in this top 16 playing green. Very, very cool to see it nonetheless. It does have its own hand control engine where it can rip many, many cards from your hand by turn 3. Couple that with, you know, Punishing Passion Rebrian, you're ripping a ton of cards out of your opponent's hand by turn 4, turn 5. And a lot of these games are going late. When you're not playing against Reboot Gohan, or if you're not playing against Vegex, you're probably going to turn 5, turn 6. So over the course of that time where Slug and Dredge Goku, which is the next deck we'll talk about here, when they have that time to rip your hand apart, it's just going to be really powerful in that regard. And Dredge Goku is not a leader that is, you know, averse to the top cut. It's been here before, hasn't been here in a while, but playing that mono green with the Maiden Transformation package has proven to be quite good. And one other thing too there is no one's playing the 2-drop extra card counterplays. Like I talked about in last week's video, the 10 cards you should side deck. Those 2-drop extra card counterplays are going to be quite good for stopping Maiden Transformation plays. Yeah, it's not super likely you're going to go up against a deck like Dredge Goku. Mono Green is not the most popular deck this format, but when you do go up against it, those 2-drop extra card counterplays are going to be quite good for those Maiden Transformation plays. But once again, best of one format, it's going to be hard to fit space in the main deck for those cards. Next up, Reboot Soul Striker. Shout out to Eggman. This is another mono blue deck that we've seen here, but we haven't seen it in the top cut of a tournament before. So very, very cool that Eggman top with this. Like I mentioned before, just a few minutes ago, when you play mono blue, your different leaders add different things to the strategy. What Reboot Soul Striker adds to the strategy is energy manipulation. And that is very, very strong. Sometimes you need to extend your turn. You don't have a ton of energy. Maybe you haven't successfully ramped. And at least in Reboot Soul Striker, you're playing different unisons. You're playing 3-drop blue unisons as opposed to Zeno most of the time. So getting that energy manipulation, in some instances, you can look at it kind of like a ramp because you're getting more energy to play with that turn. So definitely a strong deck. I think going forward, even in set 11 with the new blue tools we're getting, I think Reboot Soul Striker will see a lot more playability there as well. Next up, Bulma. This is one of the decks that is specifically built to beat Vegex. Just an abundance of blockers. You play the Baba Bandages Spike package, and in that scenario, you're just, you know, recurring blockers, recurring blockers, recurring blockers. It gets a little bit out of control. I've tested against this deck as well, and if you can't kill them early, if they get to that late game, they're drawing 2 cards per turn. They have tons of blockers, literally, you know, anywhere from 5 to 10 blockers. It's very, very hard to kill them at that point, which is very cool to see Bulma in this top cut as well. Next up, Surge Broly. Red, green. We don't see much multicolored nowadays. We see Invoker here and there. We don't see much other multicolor, but it is pretty cool to see red, green Broly in this top cut. It does some things that other decks can't do. Like, green can kind of do this with the Bardock Unison and Negotiator Krillin, but Broly, when you're playing the Broly Arrival package, you're able to control your opponent's combo area, which is going to be quite relevant against Vegex. Now, I don't know if this Broly list in particular played the red, green Broly and the Arrival stuff like that, but if it did, it would have a good advantage against Vegex. But you do lose out on Dormant Potential Unleashed, which is something you have to take into account when you're going to play these multicolored leaders. It is pretty unfortunate you lose access to, you know, some of your unison cards, like the unison counterplays, like Dormant Potential Unleashed, like Wolfang Fist. But nonetheless, definitely seems like one of the stronger multicolored decks in the format, especially since, Surge Goku and Blue Green Piccolo have been nerfed. So that being the case, cool to see it there. And finally, wrapping this up, guys, one mono black Boo. Now, whenever we've seen the mono black Boo engine, it has been in Vegex decks and it has topped here and there, but it is cool to see Boo make it back into this top cut. If for no other reason than when you're playing Vegex and you're playing the Boo engine, you have to really discard your entire hand and you really can't get it back. You know, Boo gives you that added ability to refuel your hand at the end of each turn, which I do think is going to be quite good if you want to play the Boo engine. And once again, the Boo engine, very, very aggressive, and it is tougher to deal with in a best of one format. So I guess if you're going to take away anything from this, guys, you're going to see different things in best of one formats as opposed to best of three formats. But the events we have, they're kind of the best we're getting for right now with the state of the world. But still awesome to see 120 players. Very, very cool. So guys, I want to know what you guys think in the comments below about this format, about this top cut. Thank you guys for watching. I will see you next time.